Good morning, friends. We are meeting again to discuss iconometry as the part of aesthetic system of India, as a part of the postgraduate course in visual arts, discussing philosophy and aesthetics. I'm Deepak Kannal, the ex-dean of Faculty of Fine Arts, MS University of Baroda. The purpose of this module is to introduce the canons of proportions and standards of measurements which are applied on Indian art and architecture. In this module, we'll learn about the different sources of iconometry as found in classical texts and shastras, Puranas, Agamas, epics, and also the folk traditions. We will also be learning about measurements and their standardization that has been followed in the Indian art practices. Historiography and the context of this discipline is very important, because apart from the factual study of the data, the most thought-provoking aspect of the studies of Indian art and architecture is critical study of the methodology and historiography of the same. Although there is no dearth of material available on Indian art and culture, but unfortunately only a handful of it brings meaningful conclusions. Most of the crucial rational and scientific approach that the Indian artist and the architects applied to the patternized monument, idol or image have been conveniently kept under the cover to present for a eulogized, mythical, mysterious account of art and architecture. Having said that, it is imperative to bring to light the text and the compilation of formulae that have focused on the practicalities of Indian art. These find mention in the ancient and medieval texts. The reference and the details to the canons of proportions and the standards of measurements became inevitable subject to the elaborate iconographical and iconological details of each deity that was to be represented. The images that represent a deity in its absolute form of correctness of iconography, iconology and iconometry came to be known as work of brilliance and excellence. Samarangana Sutradhar mentions that the only idol or icon that qualifies all these qualities is appropriate for worship. Such idols and images then were said to bring the due prosperity and opulence to the patron and the devotee too. Most importantly, these icons, once complete, were to place either in the central sanctorum of the temple or the house temple. More often, these were to be a part of large temples which were built not only for religious purpose but also as symbol of political victory or a kind of proclamation of power. The text mentioned also which artist is qualified to pursue task of completion of such an icon or idol. It further explains that only a novel, capable, experienced or perfect artist with a spiritual bent of mind is suitable to render perfect icons. The classical texts give extensive details and have chapters on how to represent gods and goddesses with their attributes and vehicles. This includes their bodily form in correct ratio, proportions of body parts, which leads to ideal form. It is noteworthy that the ideal human body type has been used as a reference to indicate the supreme ideal form of God. Daivo Naraha or Nrupesha are examples of perfect body types that have been used to direct specific form for the gods. Varaha Mihira's Brihat Sanhita is an example to infer how the dressing style, the ornaments, the body types of vernacular regions have got codified in iconography and iconometry. As mentioned above, Samaragana Sutradhara and Brihat Sanhita discuss iconometry in details. However, it is Chitra Sutra, a chapter or a kind of appendix of the Vishnu Dharmottara Purana, which mentions the iconometry as a series of considerations while rendering the icon. Vishnu Dharmottara Purana, which can be dated to around 6th century CE, discusses the basics of Talamal, the iconometry. It needs a mention that this is around a time period when the so-called Gupta classicism has arrived in its evolution of Indian art. Further, the essay discusses patterns of evolution and crystallization of iconometry as it took place hand in hand with iconography. Vishwakarma Shilpa also offers delineation of the subject of iconometry and throws light on the architectural aspect of ratio and proportion that was required to construct the temples. The text discusses the elevation plan of each section of the temple in relation of the other sections of the temple. Further, the Agamas give a detailed account of iconometry and iconography for idol making. The canons of proportions, along with the specific standards of measurements, find great attention in the Agamas. Texts like Manasara, Shukranitisara, Samarangana Sutradhara, and even Brihat Sanhita build on the Agama text further to give the details account of Pratyama Vidhana and Talamal. They have suggested canons of measurements and ratio and proportions of various Brahmanical deities. Also, it must be noted that with the study of Indian art, the iconometry, iconography, iconology, classification of images, poses of images, religious and philosophical aspects of each deity, tendencies of guilds and styles of craftsmanship, etc., all are interrelated and interdependent. Only an interdisciplinary approach on all of the above can bring to us accurate knowledge about Indian art. A comparative close study of asanas, that is postures, vahanas, vehicles, ayudhas, the attributes, the abhushanas, the ornaments, and the vastras, clothes and drapery, is suggested to understand Indian iconology in its entirety. Scholars like Gopinath Rao, Stella Kramrish, Jitendranath Banerjee, S.P. Gupta, Shashi Prasad Asthana, W.S. Adway, Karuna Khare, have significantly contributed to the field of study of iconography and iconometry. One can understand the various aspects of iconography and iconometry by looking at the journey of Indian sculpture. The transition from the Kushana period to Gupta and further post-Gupta period presents an interesting case study. It was during the pre-Gupta time period that the iconography and iconometry was in its developing phase. One may find several examples of how the artist and the artisans were struggling to arrive at a common standardized practice to execute the image. The Kushana period offers a diverse range of such experiments in the same. It is the developing phase, that is the Kushana period, the throbbing creative impulse of an artist can be located at its best. Then after the Gupta period presents crystallization of iconography and iconology. It is in the Gupta period that the canons of ratio, proportions and measurements get standardized and are followed strictly. They codified the iconometry and iconography and abided by the golden ratio proportions, due to which the Gupta period came to be known as the golden period of India. Post-Gupta, during the time of Chalukyas, Palas, Pratyahara, Chandelas and Eastern Gangas as the standardized iconometry and iconography blossomed even further. Similarly, in the South India, Pallavas, Pandyas, Cholas, Cheras and the later Nayakas saw comparable evolutionary pattern of iconometry and iconography. While the Pallavas present an archaic experimentation phase of iconometry, Cholas represent the classical period. Thereafter, the Nayaka period offers theatrical opulence in their sculpture. The differences in particular nomenclature can be observed within the Indian subcontinent. The North Indian temple is called a Nagara, and its dimensions and the proportions are not as same as the Dravidian, that is the South Indian style of temple. Vesara, on the other hand, becomes a culminating point of all the above two mentioned styles. Thus, every architecture varies in the standards. While referring to the vernacular text and major texts like Shilpa Ratnakara for Nagara style and Maimata for Dravidian style of architecture. Similarly, the word Tala is often seen replaced with the term Angulika in the Northern Indian Shilpa text. And the word Tala appears in much later texts, Matsya Purana, for instance. Within the Vaishnava iconography and iconometry mentions Dasha Tala for Rama, Narasimha and other gods, while Vamana Purana recommends Sapta Tala measures. As suggested in the classical text, the beauty of any idol has to be in accordance to the correctness of Tala. It is not the idol fit for worship. Such statement suggests that the aspect of divinity was instilled in the idol not by mere aesthetic stance or rather its iconometry and iconography. Apart from the standards of measurement as mentioned above as Angulas and Talamana, there are further subcategories of them. That is, the first is Swashreya, which may mean absolute standard. The standards of this style of measurement is measurements of natural object. Sahayaka, that is relative. Relative standards. In this form, the standardization, there is comparative analysis of each body parts with the other. This is also called Manangula. Tala is the main unit of measurement. In Hindu iconography, one unit is called Tala. One Tala is one palm length. That is, when the palm is spread. The longest length is measured from the tip of the thumb to the tip of the middle finger. Tala is also called Vitasthi, Mukta, Yama, Arka, Rasi or Jagati. Angula as the first unit of measurement. In this system, the Tala unit is however further divided into Angulas. One Angula is the thickness of the middle finger. One Tala has 12 Angulas. The height and the girth measurements are given in the text are according to the Tala system. As noted earlier, Varahamihira says that there are 5 kinds of men. Each has a measurement for the height and girth as follows. The Hansa Purusha is 96 angulas height as well as girth. The Shasha Purusha is 99 angulas in height and girth. The Tuchaka is 102 angulas and height and girth. Bhadra is 105 angulas in height as well as in girth. Manavya again is 108 angulas height as well as the girth. In this, the first, that is the Hansa type, is Dashatala type, while the last, the Malavya type, Dasha is 10 but Nava is 9. The measurement is taken from the top to the head, up to the hairline of Kesareka, to the bottom of the feet. The Vaikhana Sagama of South India mentions 6 ways of measurements of different parts of human body. Mana, that is the measurement of length, of height and body. Pramana is the breadth of the body. Unmana is the thickness of body. Parimana is the girth or the periphery of the body. Upamana is the interspaces between the different body parts, that is between one limb and the other. Lambamana is the total height taken along with the plumb line. There are three types, Uttama, Madhyama and Adhama measurements. The text Vaikhana Sagama mentions 124 angulas for Uttama, 120 angulas for Madhyama and 160 angulas for the Adhama type. It is further elaborates on the differences between rendering the male and the female bodies, keeping in mind the Talamar. Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva must be portrayed in 124 angulas, that is in Uttama Dashatara. Shri, Bhudevi, Uma, Saraswati are to be portrayed in 120 angulas, that is Madhyavatara. Indra, Lokapal, Surya Chandra, Bara, Tvadvadasha Adityas, 11 Rudras, 8 Vasus, the Ashwinis, Bhrugu, Markandeya, Shesha, Kartikeya, the 7 Rishis, are to be portrayed in Uttama Dashatala, that is in 116 angulas. The Yakshas, the Navagrahas, the other deities are to be portrayed in 114 angulas. Rakshasas, Asuras are to be portrayed in Navatala, that is in 108 angulas. Men are to be portrayed in Ashtatala, that is 96 angulas. Vaitala, Saptatala is 84 angulas. Pretas, that is Saptatala, 72 angulas, and the hunchbacks are to be portrayed in Panchatala, which is 60 angulas. Dwarfs are in Chatushtala, 48 angulas. Bhutas, Kinnaras, Tritalas in 36 angulas. The Kumbhadasas in Dvitala, that is 24 angulas. And Kabandas are in Ekatala, that is 12 angulas. Jain Banerjee points out that the face should be one tala length and the same one tala breadth, which in effect makes it round. However, in the sculpture of early Gupta, the South Indian Dravidian system has long faces, 14 or 13 and a half angulas in length and 12 angulas in width. As discussed above, iconometry was the set standardized ratio proportions by manuals that was to be followed in the making of an idol or structure. Thus, the canonical text on the same can be seen being applied to the courtly or the classical art and architecture. However, what is fascinating and must be brought to the consideration is the fact that even the folk arts have subscribed to their own standards of iconography and iconometry. The references to which can be traced in the folk songs of vernacular poetries. Bhakti movements, text, etc. refer to the size, scale and ratio proportions. Also, it will be relevant to mention the text Gatha Saptashati. The text of Gatha Saptashati can be dated to Hala Satavahana, one of the Satavahana kings who perhaps ruled in the 2nd century AD. In one of the 700 Gathas that are compiled in this text, there is an interesting mention of Trivikrama Vishnu manifesting himself from a dwarf to the all-compassing Trivikrama, who is able to measure into two steps the entire two worlds. What is intriguing in this story is the discussion between the adolescent girls, one of whom teases the other of her attaining puberty. The reference here is made to Trivikrama's amplifying its size and form in context to the advent of puberty, which is reflected on the bosom of one of the females in conversation. It must be noted that although classical texts do mention iconometry, not all the icons or idols were made following it by strict measures. The artist guilds and the acharya continued to render the idol with their artistic sensibility and experiences, not following the text word to word. Thus, what has come down to us is the artistic brilliance of the experienced hands and the genius of meticulously compiled iconometry in the classical text. The manner in which iconometry and iconography was strictly followed of Surya, it was not followed in the representation of all the other deities. Similarly, it has been observed that the bronze sculptures can be taken as the best examples to study iconometry. While the sculptures in terracotta do not present exactness of iconometry as offered in the text.